Hello and welcome, fellow wasteland survivors. Nasty Bones here, and in today's video, I'm on my very first playthrough tune, Broken Bones. And as we stroll up the main street of Sanctuary, I'd like to take a second and talk about some upcoming content that you can expect to see here on my YouTube channel. Now, over the last couple of months, I've really neglected getting any tips and tricks videos out. I've been so busy doing some of these epic raider builds and vassal builds. I've even done a couple of competition builds, and I'm just not getting out the content that I'm hoping to get out or have been wanting to get out. Also, I do have a very large GTA community, and I've been promising them videos as well, and I just haven't been delivering. So we're going to make sure and get those ones out as well over the next couple of months. Okay, one final thing before we get started. Recently, I've gotten quite a few new subscribers and followers, and they've left me a lot of comments on how I present my content. Now, most of it's good, but some of it's bad. But this is still very important to me because it helps me understand what it takes to present videos that are fun and entertaining so that you don't get bored with them. So over the next few videos, I'm going to actually be making a few changes on how I present them. And as a matter of fact, in this video, I do have a new intro. So shoot me a comment, let me know what you guys think, and expect to see more cool changes in my videos. All right, we're finally here. Welcome to Tanner's Toy Factory. Now, originally this started off to be a build and a video for one of my grandsons, which is why the entrance has a very kiddie look to it. But it didn't take long for this to become so much more, and I decided to go ahead and keep the entrance the way it was because it really gives a false sense of what you can expect to find inside this factory. Now, the first part of this video is a little bit of a walkthrough, and we're going to visit parts of the factory that we're just not going to see during the rest of the video. So, why we do it? Let's hear a little music, and I'll see you guys back here in a short. Thank you. Okay, now that we've had a little bit of a teaser look, let's actually get to the meat and potatoes of this factory. First of all, it is a 100% fully automated facility. I spent a lot of time in figuring out every need that I might want and to do it with the greatest of ease. Now, first of all, we're going to take a look at this little room, which I'm sorry, I don't have a light in here, and so we'll turn on the Pip Boy. But this is my extraction room and where I place in my junk and my items. And we'll just take a quick look of what I've already got in the steamer trunk. Now, originally, I was going to dump everything that I have here in Sanctuary into it. And thankfully, I didn't. Because even though I have just that amount of junk in there, it still took a long time for this to process. And we'll see more about that as we continue. Okay, let's head on up to the third floor and where the factory control center is at. Now, I know there's not a lot of lighting right now, but there's a reason for that, and that'll become more evident as we progress through the video. Now, the control center is designed to actually oversee the whole entire facility, and I actually did pretty good with the exception of a couple of things that are right underneath of us. But I do have the lights on that are down in the manufacturing area, and I'll turn them off before we get started. But let's take a quick look at the switches that I use to control the facility. Now, there are quite a few. There are one switch on each wall that I'm actually not using. I just didn't take them off because I didn't want that to be unbalanced. And I thought also you guys might like to take a look and see what it looked like just before I actually installed the walls in, so you could see all the cool wiring and how I ran it. I did spend a lot of time on the electrical and wiring to this facility, and it gives it another unique aspect on how the systems in this factory actually operate and work. Okay, first thing we're going to want to do is flip on the power to our system. This actually controls everything we're going to be working with from here on out. And you can see I've already turned off the lights downstairs, so we don't have those bothering us, so we can see how the lighting actually works here. Now, the first thing we're going to want to do is flip on the storage. And as you can see, this is the conveyor belt that's going to actually bring our junk to our component sorters. And see how it all lit up. That's why we don't have lights on. So we can see each system and how it works. Now, I do have two rows of sorters, one on the top floor, one on the bottom, and you can see the lights for those have now actually come on. And we've already started to get our first pieces of junk coming into the system to be sorted. Now, as I was making this video, I ran across a couple of problems, issues. One of them was this elevator conveyor would plug up once in a while, and not just this one, several of them would. Now, it turned out to not be a real big issue. I discovered I could actually turn the system off, turn it back on, and it would usually unplug it. And once again, it wasn't a huge issue, but it is kind of worth mentioning. Alright, let's take a little trip across this top conveyor. Here we can see the top four separators, and you can see they're working and items are being separated, and ones that aren't being accepted in these ones are being passed on to go to the second floor, which has four separators down there. Now, out of the eight separators, I'm only using six. And the reason is because of the six forges I'm actually using right now. These are the only components that I need to create anything in those particular forges. And if I was to ever change out and swap to another forge, I may need extra components that I'm not calculated into this system yet, and the two extra separators will give me that flexibility to do that. Now, the way I designed these separators is so that at no given time do I have to send any more than 2 or 3 to any of the forges to create whatever items I want to make. I didn't want to have to run all of my junk through the whole system to create 1 or 2 items. Now, at the end of this video, in annotations and in the description, I'll give a detailed list of the components that I've got in each sorter that made this actually happen. Now, what we're watching here is the items that didn't get accepted by the top sorters being passed on to the second floor. Now, what I've got here is I've got a storage conveyor with a vacuum hopper, and I'm pulling those items out of the storage container to run them through the sorters that I have here on the second floor. Now, I'm only using the two first sorters, the two far right ones I'm not actually using. They are still connected to the system and still working, just nothing's being sorted. And as items don't get accepted here, they'll pass on through and go to another storage container, which we'll see a little later in the video. Alright, now that all of our junk is separated and sorted, let's go ahead and turn this part of the system off. And once again, you can see all the lights and the conveyors have gone off, and we're back into darkness again. And I think, let's make something. Let's make some ammo. So I'm going to turn on the ammo switch, which turns on the forge, and you can actually see a whole new set of lights have lit up and conveyors are running. Now this is going to be what's going to feed our ammo forge. But before we do that, we need to access our terminal. And there's a couple of reasons why. First of all, I want to show you that you can actually access and change any settings to any of the things that you have connected to your system, even if they're on or not. And we're going to go ahead and choose the ammo forge, and these are the different types of ammo that we can actually create. Now I'm going to go ahead and choose 45s, and they're going to require 2 steel, 1 fertilizer. Also, a little later on, we're going to actually make some shotgun shells as well. Now that we've chosen what we're going to make, and we've seen what it's going to take to make it, let's turn on a couple of these vacuum hoppers. And these hoppers are actually connected to some conveyor storage units. And they're holding all the items that we've just separated and sorted. And yes, you can see the first items are starting to come out on the first floor. Now these 4 elevator conveyors are connected to the bottom floor, and they're starting to spit out the items that we're going to need as well. Now let's take a trip downstairs and let's follow these items as they make their journey and make their way down to the ammo forge. Now, the conveyor part of the system that we're viewing right now is actually going to be used to feed all of our forges. But the little arm that you see right there directing it into this forge is actually connected to each forge, and they'll be operated on and off by turning the forges on and off. Now, I'm sorry I forget the name of it. Next time I might be a little better prepared, but probably not. And as you can see, lighting is a little scarce here, but keep in mind this is an automated system. I really shouldn't need to be down here, and the only reason I'm here right now is for this video purpose. So I'm going to go ahead and use the Pip-Boy for the rest of the video in these darker areas so we can see how this stuff's working. And as it continues to feed into the ammo forge, the only thing we really got to do now is just kind of wait until all the components that we need arrive. Alrighty then, after what seems like hours, our final components are starting to get here. Fertilizer. And so we'll watch it drop down into the forge here, and hopefully it'll start making ammo. Oh, yep, there it goes. And it's going to start making our 45s. Now what's going to happen here is as it makes the bullets, it's going to drop them out on this conveyor storage. And we're going to hold it in storage. And we'll take a look at that just a little later in the video, how this part of the system actually works. We're not going to want to have to come down here and collect our ammo. We're going to want it to be brought to us. Now that we've finished making our 45 shells, Let's run back up to the control booth, the control center, and we're going to access the terminal. Now what we're going to do is we're going to change over and we're going to make shotgun shells. So we'll go down, we'll choose that, and this is going to take a couple of extra things that we don't have yet. 2 lead, 2 plastic, 2 fertilizer. And lead is one of the things we don't have in our system yet. So what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and turn on another hopper to feed our conveyors that are bringing them into our forge. Now what I could have done and should have done is turned off our pre-existing hoppers, vacuum hoppers. And the reason is it just would have quit producing stuff from those sorters, and we wouldn't have had so much to send back when we were finished. Now the elevator conveyor is, there it is, connected to the bottom. That's where the lead's at. And here comes our lead. So now our first components that we're going to need to create shotgun shells are now on their way. As we're watching the lead finally get here, you probably saw a little bit of the clogging issue. But if you noticed, it actually took care of itself, and therefore no real big issue. And once again, the forge is starting to work and produce and make our shotgun shells. And they're going to come out just like the 45s did. They're going to go on to this conveyor storage and go into storage for later on when we want to retrieve them. And we'll just watch one more get made here real quick. All right, working great. Now that this is all done, let's head back upstairs, and what we're going to want to do is shut the entire system down. And the reason is we're going to want to send all of our unused components back to the sorters. But we're going to want to leave our ammo forge on. And the reason is because we're going to want to take and get everything that is still on the conveyor belts feeding it back into that particular forge before we send it back into the sorters. And we'll just wait for it to all reach its destination and get to where it needs to go. And as you can see, the last items are finally getting here and going into the forge. Now we can actually go ahead and send it all back to our separators. But first, let's turn off the ammo forge. And with all the systems off, so is all of our lighting. And now we're ready to retrieve all the unused components and items in our ammo forge and bring them back upstairs to be resorted. And as you can see, a whole new set of lights have come on. These lights are actually highlighting this particular conveyor belt. And we'll jump down real quick so we can see how this is actually working. Now, what I've done is I've connected a vacuum hopper to the ammunition plant, the ammunition forge. And it's going to suck out all the unused items and components that are in there, place them on this conveyor, send them up the elevator conveyor right there, back up to the top floor where we can resort them again. But first, we're going to take another look at some of the plugging issue that we had. And once again, it wasn't a real big issue. It did take care of itself, but I just kind of wanted to show you that here and there it does plug up a little bit. Now it's going to go across this conveyor and go up this elevator conveyor back to the top floor where the initial junk actually came in, and you can see it going on down the conveyor belt to be sorted. But if you noticed, because I didn't, none of the lights for the separators are on. Yes, I did forget to turn the separators on. So I actually ended up with a hell of a mess at the end of that conveyor. And it took me a minute to get it all actually resorted and put back into its actual containers. And once again, we can see that with the systems off, all the lights are off. And I think it's time to make some explosives. So let's make some explosives. Once again, with our system on, all of our lights come on. There is a new light on down at the bottom. We can't really see it here, but we'll see it when we get downstairs. Now, first thing again, what we're going to want to do is choose what we're going to make, and I think plasma grenades. Plasma grenades are pretty powerful. I think somewhere around 360 or something like that. And these are the items it's going to take: adhesive, aluminum, circuitry, nuclear material, and springs. So now that we've chosen what we're going to make and what items that we need to make, let's go ahead and choose the vacuum hoppers that are actually holding those components. Now, this one is going to take three. And the reason is it's going to take two that have the major components and then the one that has the steel and the adhesive. And then we'll take a look. Oh, yep, here they come. Comes our first components that we're going to need. And it looks like cameras. Is that what it is? Oh, here comes some steel. Steel's on its way. And all we need to do now is just kind of wait for it to all get down into the explosive forge, and we'll make some plasma grenades. And once again, we're going to kind of follow it on its trip down to the bottom. And the reason is because I want to show you how the same conveyor is actually feeding all of the forges, but how it's choosing which forge to go to. Now, if you notice, that arm is not closed, but this arm is. And once again, it's linked to the forge. So whichever forge I actually have on is the particular forge that that arm will close on, which will allow these items and these components to reach their destination that I have chosen. Also, you can notice that the light over the explosives forge is actually on now instead of the ammunition forge. And we'll just watch a couple of these items drop down in here. I do have a couple of these little concrete walls and glass windows here to help kind of catch stuff so that it doesn't actually fall off the conveyors. And now that everything that we need has reached here, springs, I think, was the last thing we needed. Bam, there we go. We're making plasma grenades. And once again, the plasma grenades are dropping on to the storage conveyor and going into storage so that we can retrieve them later on when we want to. And you can see we still got 45 rounds in there. We've got shotgun shells in there. And we're starting to get our plasma grenades. Alright, now that I'm finished making plasma grenades, it's time to send everything back upstairs to be resorted. And as you can see, this time I did not forget to turn the sorters on. And we just go ahead and flip the switches that we need to, and the vacuum hopper starts pulling all the unused components that are in the explosive forge back onto the same conveyor and sending them upstairs. And these are all the different components that were left inside the explosives forge. And once again, they all come across and go up top and are heading back to the sorters. And as you can see, this time my sorter lights are on. And everything worked great. They resorted themselves and everything went right back to where it was supposed to be. And with everything back to where it's supposed to be, it's time to turn everything off. Now, one thing I want to show you guys before we continue is I have an overflow system. There are several components that I don't use in crafting anything that I have forges for. And I have an actual container that catches these. And we're going to check to see if it's actually working. And yes, it is. These are items that I don't actually use in anything that I'm going to be making. And it's simply connected to the very last sorter. That way, anything that isn't chosen by a sorter will actually just be deposited into that container, and it makes it easy for retrieval. That way, I don't have a lot of junk in my system, or I should say, a lot of unnecessary junk that isn't needed. Now, for this next couple of segments, we're just going to take a quick look at a couple of other forges as I turn them on. And we're just kind of noticing how the little arms are open or closed, allowing the junk and the components to go in the direction that I want them to go in, or to that particular forge. And as our final one here, we're just kind of looking at the heavy weapons And you can see that little arm is moved over, which allows the junk to go towards that forge. All right, now that we have finished making all the things that we're going to make today, it's time to retrieve our loot. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how this works. It actually has two functions. The first function that we're going to check out right now is actually retrieving any items that we have crafted or made in our forges. And they have vacuum hoppers that are hooked to the conveyor storages that the actual items went into from the forges. And as you can see, here comes the first sets of ammo that we made. And following up behind is actually the plasma grenades. Now, the way this works is it feeds it into this conveyor storage right here, which is actually part of the main room where we placed our junk to begin with in the beginning of the video. That way, all I have to do when I come to this factory is visit that room or go up to the control booth or the control center. I don't have to go anywhere else in this entire factory to do anything. And this is the only two places that I'll actually end up being. And as you can see, we got 220 rounds of 45s, 10 plasma grenades, 100 shotgun shells, and I'll just go ahead and retrieve all that. And then run back upstairs and shut that part of the system off again. And once again, all the lighting's off and everything's dark. Alright, by now I'm sure you guys have noticed this switch. Well, it has a very unique function, which actually brings us back to the loot when I said that the loot system has actually two functions. And I'm going to go ahead and use the energy weapon part of our system to explain how this works. Now, I'm going to go ahead and flip on the return. What I've done is I've placed around 20 cans into the energy weapons forge. And the vacuum hopper is going to suck those out just like we were going to send them back in to be resorted again. So they'll continue on their path, on their way back to be resorted, all the way up to this point right here. This is where this switch comes into play. It actually flips this little arm bar right here so we can change the path. And the reason for this is let's say that after making a lot of items, we're starting to get an excessive amount of components or items. And instead of putting them back into our system where it takes so long to resort and distribute and bring these items into our forges, we want to get rid of them. We want to bring them out because it's just getting to be too many. So what it does is it separates it from this point on. And they'll drop down and drop on to the loot table or the loot conveyor. And from that point on, they actually travel through the loot conveyor into our storage conveyor. And at this point here, all I have to do is just go in there and retrieve any excess items that I may have chosen to take out of the system. This is just another great idea that helps keep my facility, my factory, fully automated. I don't have to go anywhere out there. All I have to do is come right here to the loot conveyor storage or up to the control center. And as you can see, the cans are coming in, and all we'd have to do is just retrieve out whatever we have sent here, loot included. And I'll go ahead and pick them up, and let's go ahead and head on back up and take one more final look at that. And we can see how the arm is actually open, which is sending all those components on this separate conveyor down to our loot conveyor. And I'll just go ahead and go on up. We'll shut it off. But this time, instead of going down and looking at it, we'll just use the sniper rifle and look at it through the floor. And you can see it's now open. This is a great way that I can actually sit there and manually flip that switch on and off and take out whatever components or items I want to out of the system. And then once I'm done, I just go ahead and once again shut it all back down. Alright, well, before we end this video, I'd like to take you around and show you a couple of more things real quick. I managed to get a couple of neat little shots. I love this little part of the footage here. It really shows how cool I ran the lighting. And that's going to be one of the things that I'll be going over in my tips and tricks videos that'll be coming up shortly. I did get a little bit of daylight, and I got all the lights on in the facility to help light it all up. Even though nothing's going or coming through, I disconnected the vacuum hoppers. I was able to light everything up really good so we could get a good look at how I've set everything up here. And this is the bottom floor of the separators, which the actual overflow conveyor storage is hooked to. Here's a good look at some of the electrical conduit that I ran. This was quite fun, quite interesting. It did take a lot of planning and a lot of figuring out to get it to run like this. And then to top it off, I built these cool little stands that look like it's holding these up. I feel it really gives it a great factory look. It really looks awesome. Instead of just floating in the air there, it looks like those little stands are actually holding it up. And it's meant to actually be there. And this is the upper floor where the separators are at. And once again, I'll just take a little quick ride across this top conveyor so we can take a good look at it in some really good light. Like I said, I got all my lights on. I just disconnected those vacuum hoppers right there, so none of my components or junk actually went out into the system. And then when I got finished, I just hooked them all back up again. And also, once again, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you. Thank you very much for your support on my channel over the last 11 months or so. I really love building these builds and making these videos. And from the amount of subscribers I've been getting lately and the comments, I can tell you guys are loving it too. Also, you know, shoot me a comment. Let me know what you guys think about the changes that I'm doing. Give me any other ideas on changes that I could do to make my video content even better. All right, everybody, thank you very much. And if you haven't already subscribed, please don't forget to. I do have a lot more content coming out, and I'd love to share it with you. All right, everybody, until next time, please stay safe.